Welcome friends to the next episode of my video series on software engineering. And in this episode, I am going to talk to you about understanding the requirements. Requirements are classifications by these three ways. One is functionality considerations, and these requirements fulfill the set of selected business processes and deliver the results to end users. Then second set of requirements is the product construction considerations. These considerations help us in constructing the product, how the current product is to be built, and as to maintain it later on. Third set is source that provides requirement. Who provides the requirement? The end users, the development team, marketing, or whoever it is. And from the functionality standpoint, we have two types of requirements: core functionality requirements and ancillary functionality requirements. Core functionality requirement of the product are the product is designed to fulfill this functionality. Without fulfilling this functionality, there is no use. The product becomes useless. Ancillary functionality is the support functionality of the core functionality. You know, the product is still usable even if the ancillary functionality is completely absent. But it may cause inconvenience. Absence of ancillary functionality may cause inconvenience and may lead to errors. But core functionality is the one for which we are building the product, and it is the basis and it is the primary requirement of the product. And here is the pictorial representation. This is the ancillary functionality, and this is the core functionality. The relation is 25-75, but it need not always be the same. It may change from situation to situation. And functionality requirement, a customer would not specify this ancillary functionality. This ancillary functionality, we cannot expect the customer or the end user to specify. Statutory functionality, the functionality that is defined to meet the statutory requirements set by the governments. Safety functionality, usage safety, security, securing the data and the interests of the user. Usability functionality, how easy it is to use our product. Data integrity, the integrity of the data that is coming in and going out has to be maintained. This functionality is data integrity functionality. Response time functionality, whenever a user gives a command, how fast or how much time the computer takes, our system takes to respond to the customer. And this also is critical in many applications. Memory constraint, the RAM that is available in the computer may be limited or may be available, especially in automobiles and machine applications. The RAM is very limited, and this has to be taken as a constraint. Software footprint functionality, when we are giving a product or a utility, how much space it occupies both on the disk and on the memory. This is a constraint. We cannot make it more than that. And fault tolerance functionality, how much fault it can tolerate. Users make mistakes and that has to be tolerated. Reliability functionality, how reliable our product should be. Reliability is delivering the expected level of performance over a period of time. Feel good functionality, the people should be proud to display this. It must give them a feeling that they are happy with this. They give their esteem. Esteem functionality, that they should be proud to exhibit that. One-upmanship, or it is also called as competitive edge functionality. All these will not be defined by the user. This may be defined by the marketing people or advertising people or the project team itself or the management. This is a pictorial representation of all the various functionalities. The proportion is just representational purpose. This is not actual representation. It changes from scenario to scenario. And ancillary functionality requirements based on product construction considerations. The product must be maintainable, it should be flexible, it should be testable, it should be reusable, and it should be portable from one system to the other. Operations, how the operations are carried out, their convenience also must be taken into consideration, and interfacing with the existing systems or the future systems, all these are to be specified, and customer or the end user cannot be expected to specify these ancillary requirements. And of course, this is a pictorial representation, and the proportions shown are only for illustrative purposes and not actuals. What constitutes a software application? Normally, a software application has these three: input processes, output processes, and associative processes. Inputs take input from the users, and outputs process gives outputs on the screen, on the paper, or wherever to the users. And associative processes are the ones that validate the inputs before taking them inside, and validate the outputs and formats the output before they are taken out. These three are the processes. Software application consists of basically these three processes. Now, each process has these attributes: inputs. Each process receives certain inputs. Outputs. Each process delivers some outputs. The outputs may even be to the disk to store data. Process. Each process carries out some transformation of inputs and converts them to outputs. They may be intermediate outputs or final outputs. Triggers. Each process needs a trigger to initiate the process into execution. These four attributes. And evolution of requirement, how the requirements evolve. If we are developing a new product that is not existing in the market, then first thing is idea germination. The idea has to come to somebody. Then brainstorming about its usability, its flexibility, its marketability, and its technical possibility. And then a market, customer, or consultant surveys are carried out depending on our budget and reach. Then this may be followed by or include personal interviews, then build a prototype and demonstrate it to various audience, then freeze the requirements after all these are done. If we are developing a new product for us, but it is already existing in the market, idea germination, let us go in competition with the existing product or products. Then we conduct a market or customer or consultant surveys whether we have a space in the market. Personal interviews, if necessary, brainstorming about various aspects, then prototype. And after demonstration of the prototype and the receiving the feedback, requirements are frozen. And now, revolution of requirements in project development scenario. And in this, there are two: in-house project or external project. Now, the in-house project is new project or upgrade for an existing product. Now, the proposal for in-house project is by a functional department, and the user requirements definition, either the user defines or we talk to the users and define, then finalization of the user requirements. And if it is an outsourced project, new or upgrade, project acquisition, first step is we have to acquire the project. Then we attempt the requirements elicitation or gathering and both. Analyze the requirements. What is analysis? We will be seeing in the future videos. Finalize the requirements and then obtain customer's approval for the frozen requirements. So friends, this is about understanding of the requirements. I thank you for watching this video, and we will meet with other video in my next episode. Thank you. Have a great day. Consider subscribing to my channel.